G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. In this video, I add the first components to what will eventually become the main drive wheel assembly. Now, I had expected that this would just be a quick task on the way to completing the input crown wheel assembly, and I even went as far as preparing the raw stock for that part of the job. But fitting B2 ended up being quite an interesting process on its own, so I'll cover the crown wheel assembly in the next video instead. I started by marking out the blank with 64 divisions, using the shop-made dividing plate shown in a previous video. Next, I formed the teeth using one of the files custom made for the purpose. Be sure to check out that video if you haven't seen it already, as well as the related video on case hardening. Now, before I do any more work with this wheel, I'd like to show you a bit more detail on where it fits into the mechanism. It's permanently fastened to the main solar drive wheel B1, and it's part of the gearing associated with the back half of the device. In fact, it's the first wheel in that large and quite complex part of the mechanism. It engages two wheels that in turn drive the gearing that animates the eclipse prediction display, the calendar display, and the lunar phase display on the front dial. Now, that's a lot of gears generating a lot of friction, so the load on B2 and its rivets is considerable, and the maker has addressed this issue in the design of the component. First, by making it quite stout. It has a relatively small diameter, and it's one of the thickest wheels in the mechanism. And secondly, the scans show four quite substantial rivets placed in a symmetrical pattern around the spokes that firmly hold B2 in place. It's a very neat solution that wouldn't be out of place in a modern clock mechanism. Now, the central bore of B2 needs to be opened up to match the main bearing, and it could be done simply by drilling it out on a drill press, but I decided to relocate the part back on the lathe to do the job. It makes it much easier to hold and ensures good concentricity with the teeth. A light rub and some abrasive paper took care of the small burr thrown up when I filed the teeth, and that's B2 complete for now. Next up, I made the circular spacer that fits on the other side of B1, and you'll notice that I haven't used any marking fluid to make that circle more visible. I've done this to show just how hard it can be to see even a simple object line on bare metal. Even up close, I think you'll agree, it's not exactly the clearest line that you could hope for, particularly if you're working on something really critical like, say, filing some teeth or locating a hole. So I think it's reasonable to assume that the ancients would have tried to improve this situation with some sort of equivalent to our modern marking dies. If they did, it would have needed to be something that was easy to apply and remove, and hopefully robust enough to take a fair amount of handling before it wore off. It would also have needed to provide a distinct colour contrast to make the lines stand out to the naked eye. Of course, marking out rarely happens in isolation. There's usually a few alignment tools required to get that scriber exactly where it needs to be, and this job is no different. So I've made a couple of small alignment pins to help me out. One to locate parts on the division plate, and one to bring all three components into alignment for drilling out the rivet hole positions. Now, it certainly doesn't meet the requirement of robust handling, but a very straightforward marking material worth investigating is candle soot. It can be applied and removed easily, and the contrast it provides is excellent. Thank you. The positions for the four holes are now firmly located over the centerline of each of the spokes and can now be drilled out in preparation for accepting the rivets. And as tempting as it is to just drop in all four rivet holes at once, even the slightest movement of the work whilst drilling can lead to an unacceptable misalignment of the holes. So the standard clockmaking approach is to play it safe and drop in a steady pin first to lock the orientation. The hole is taper broached and then a pin with a matching taper is tapped into place. It gives a very precise and reliable lock and the pin can easily be tapped out later in the process. The four rivets were turned to size and left just long enough to allow them to be comfortably held for insertion. By now, of course, a lot of the soot has worn off, so I think it's clear that it really wouldn't be suitable for marking out anything that needs a lot of handling, like for example the wheels. But despite that flaw, it did a reasonable job in this situation, so I'll keep it in mind for some future parts. If you can think of any other materials that might be plausible, then be sure to let me know in the comments below. The steady pin was removed and the location drilled out for the last rivet. I reduced the length of the rivets using the belt sander, and then started the process of permanently setting them in place. I made sure that each rivet end was thoroughly peened, and that the metal was well pushed out into the chamfer, giving not just a seamless join, but also good solid mechanical strength. And for the final step, I used a file and 800 grit abrasive paper to blend the rivets into the surrounding metal. The process of riveting has pulled the parts firmly together, creating a good join. And that mass at the centre has had an interesting effect on the feel of the main drive wheel. It now has quite a decent heft to it. And as I reach the end of this video, it's hard to escape the thought that over 2,000 years ago, there was a moment just like this, when this iconic assembly was given its first trial fit on the main bearing. And the maker, carefully assessing the work, watched it turn for the very first time. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later. Now, if geared mechanisms like this are your thing and you'd like to help me make more of these videos, then consider becoming a Clickspring patron. As a patron of the channel, you get immediate access to the patron series of videos. This includes the 5 videos from the wedge-style hand vise build, and at present, the first 4 videos of the Byzantine sundial calendar build, with more to come as the project progresses. In the most recent episode, I made the small assemblies that will one day predict eclipses in the mechanism. And don't forget that as a patron, you also get free access to the plans for the patron series projects, so you can follow along and build them yourself if you wish. Now, as an added patron reward, for a limited time, I'm also offering $10 off on your purchase of the Clickspring Fire Piston. It's a terrific little fire starting device, based on the prototype that I made some time ago, and it makes a great addition to any camping or hiking bag. So be sure to visit patreon.com/clickspring to find out more. Thanks again for watching. I'll catch you on the next video.